Origins, written by Michael Panek and Guershon Moreno. Fade in, exterior space. In the vast blackness of space, there is a planet similar to Earth, except it is surrounded by a glass-like force field. A massive spaceship armed with cannons and fighter docking bays approaches the planet and hides behind the moon. Interior, Kieran mothership, bridge. On the command bridge, the crew is made up of Kierans, pale, with red eyes and fangs. They control the ship, checking monitors and pushing buttons. At the helm sits Captain STIBOR, large and powerful looking, and he and the rest of the crew man their positions on the main screen in front of them.
We're out of the Harkaria's range of detection.
Good. Commence planetary infiltration program.
Aye, aye, Captain.
And the jamming frequency?
Helmsman number 2 finishes typing in a sequence, followed by a beep.
Jamming sequence initiated, sir.
STIBOR smiles and licks his lips, just as his doors open to reveal DRAGOLA, delicate and slender-looking, with an air of refinement the others lack. All of them jump out of their seats and kneel before him, as Captain STIBOR takes DRAGOLA's hand and kisses it.
Your Highness.
Arise.
They do so, and get back to work as STIBOR arises, towering over DRAGOLA.
We are in position and await your order.
DRAGOLA regards him a moment.
Had I not come in when I did, would you have given the order?
STIBOR opens his mouth to protest.
Sir, the window of opportunity.
DRAGOLA grabs the large Kieran around the throat and lifts him up with ease as STIBOR struggles in vain against Dragola's vice-like grip.
You would do well to not forget your place, Captain.
DRAGOLA releases STIBOR, letting him fall to the ground and gasping for air.
Launch the shuttle.
Yes, sir.
Exterior space. On the Kieran ship, one of the many docking bays open, an armored personnel transport launch and cloak invisible as they head toward the Earth-like planet. Planet Hatarian, day. It's a pristine planet with lush forests, mountains, streams, and lakes. Scattered amidst the dense flora are high-tech pyramids and what looks like the Sphinx, but made of glass, a perfect coexistence between nature and technology. In the clearing, several Harkanians, human-looking in every way, work alongside Greys, small humanoid creatures with big black eyes. They reap a field, working together, until the sound and force of a cloak APC landing sends them cowering, running for the cover in the forest. There's a tense moment as the engines power down to a low whir, and the hull decloaks. The Harkanians watch from behind the cover of some shrubbery.
Well, there goes the rest of the workday.
Harkanian farmer number 2 hushes him as the APC's door opens and armored Kierans march out and secure the perimeter. A gray farmer sneezes. The Kieran's ears perk up, pinpointing the sound. The scared farmers run for their lives into the forest. But the grays are slow. A Kieran grabs a gray, sinking his fangs into the little farmer, drinking him dry. After a moment, the Kieran drops the gray's lifeless body in disgust and spits out a mouthful of green blood. Harkarian Village. It's a community made out of homes and shops that shares the land with the forests, trees, and animals. Harkanians and Greys go about their daily business. In an alley, Nyx, 11, short and chubby, is bullied by a group of older boys.
You think you're so smart, don't you?
Come on! Maybe if my grandfather was Gagraeus the Great, I'd get the highest marks in science, too.
Well, maybe if you paid attention once in a while.
Bully number 2 pushes Nyx to the ground.
What did you say?
Nyx turns pale, white, and cowers.
Nyx, come on.
The bullies turn to see Xanthippe, 12, long hair, pretty, and athletic.
But we're not done yet.
Yes, we are.
She goes over to Nyx and pulls him onto his feet, but the bullies surround her. She stands face to face with the biggest bully of them all, bully number 1.
Look at her. She's as delusional as her crazy old grandfather. I bet your parents would die all over again if they saw what kind of freak you turned out to be.
Nyx drops his head, but Xanthippe flushes red with anger, and before bully number 1 knows it, he's been kicked in the stomach and thrown to the ground. Xanthippe wails on him as tears of rage run down her cheeks. The other bullies step back in horror.
Please stop! I'm sorry!
Xan, stop, please.
Ignoring him, he tries to pry his sister off the bully, but she shoves him to the ground and continues. On the street, Gorgias, 70, thin, with thick beard, walks with Madras, another old Harkonnen, dressed in civil servant's uniform.
But the algorithm for the planetary defense system is far too simple. It needs to be rebuilt from the ground up. Now, I've been working with a new elemental compound that...
The Council would never agree to such an expenditure of time and resources.
It's obsolete technology that any primitive or savage with interstellar travel capabilities can breach.
Gorgias, old friend, I appreciate your concern, but we have not had a threat since our alliance with the Atlanteans.
Gorgias waves him off.
We are defenseless, old friend.
The sounds of the crying bully and Nick's voice get his attention.
We'll finish this later.
Gorgias approaches the crowd of kids, pushing them aside, and sees an enraged Xanthippe atop the unconscious bully.
Zan!
He pulls her off the boy and grabs Nyx, marching them away. Interior, Gorgias' home, living room. A well-kept, ancient-looking room with comfortable seats. It is decorated with old devices and artifacts. In the center of the room is a large hologram screen with complicated mathematical equations and detailed schematics. Xanthippe and Nyx sit as Gorgias paces back and forth, angry.
You could have killed him.
I was protecting my brother.
That was far more than just protecting Nyx.
He called you a delusional old man.
Violence is not the Harkarian way.
He said that mother and father would die all over again if they saw how it had turned out.
Gorgias stops and sighs. He sits down next to Xanthippe, taking her hand in his.
Xan.
I'm sorry.
He smiles sadly.
You're so much like your mother.
A tear rolls down Xanthippe's cheek.
Nothing is more important to me than you and your brother.
Gorgias hugs his grandchildren. Planet, Atlantia Day. The planet's surface is completely covered in water. Beneath the clear water are several structures on the ocean floor. A large sea creature breaches the surface and plunges back into the water, heading down to Crystal City. It's a gleaming metropolis of towering buildings and structures, all made of crystal. A large sea creature hovers between two buildings, among a school of fish, as they live in harmony with the Atlanteans. Suddenly, a manta-shaped craft with Ministry of Science printed on its side rounds a building and narrowly misses a large sea creature and school of fish, scattering them in a frenzy. Inside the science craft sits Cleto, a blonde-haired beauty wearing a metallic-colored flight suit as she yips and laughs. Next to her is Ezekiel, lanky and soft, gripping the sides of his seat with eyes shut.
We're gonna die! We're gonna die! We're gonna die!
You can open your eyes now.
He looks behind him at the narrow miss.
Why do I let you talk me into this?
It must be my girlish charm.
Ezekiel rolled his eyes.
Hey, I heard there's an opening for fighter pilot school. Why don't you...
Cleo smiles faint.
And end up a combat instructor while my male classmates get to actually fight? No thank you.
Crystal City. The craft speeds down between the buildings, narrowly dodging sea life and other crafts. Among them is a craft with weapons and Ministry of Justice stamped on its doors. It takes off after Cleto's craft. Back inside the science craft, Ezekiel looks behind them and sees the justice craft tailing them. He shrinks into his seat and sighs.
Well, there goes my career.
Cleo looks at the screen as the justice craft is hailing them.
By order of the Ministry of Justice, you are ordered to stop.
Ezekiel moves to respond, but Cleo punches the screen and breaks the intercom.
What are you doing?
I tried responding, but the comm was down and the controls were malfunctioning.
Ezekiel gives her a quizzical look before she takes an evasive maneuver and making Ezekiel shut his eyes. Crystal City. Cleto's craft speeds up and barrels rolls away from her pursuer. But the Justice craft follows and powers up its front cannon. It fires, narrowly missing Cleto's craft. Back inside the science craft, Cleto watches the pulse whiz right by them.
Cleto, stop! They're shooting at us!
Relax, it's just an EMP round.
Crystal City. Cleto's ship is now followed by six Justice crafts, all shooting EMP rounds at her, none of them hitting her. A stray EMP round hits crafts and buildings, turning them off and making them go dark. A pod of giant whale-like creatures swims slowly through the city. Cleto dives her ship between the massive animals. A stray EMP round hits the largest one. It makes a deafening sound and riles the other pod members. The justice crafts run into them, disabling the crafts. Back inside the science ship, Cleo looks behind her and smiles triumphantly.
See? No big deal.
She rounds a building's corner and comes face to face with the entire fleet of justice crafts, with their cannons pointed at them.
No big deal, huh?
Cleo powers down the craft and sighs. Courtroom day. It's a room made of crystal with a high podium where seven judges, 60 to 70, men and women, sit in white robes. Judge Ignatius, 78, the high judge, stern and hard, sits in the middle and higher than the others. Between them stand Ezekiel and Piro on one side and the bruised justice officers on the other.
Property damage, sea life disturbed. Do you have anything to say for yourselves?
Your Honor, our craft, you see, it malfunctioned and...
Cleto places a hand over his.
Zeke, it's okay. It's my fault, sir. Engineer Ezekiel had no prior knowledge of my actions. I take full responsibility.
Am I supposed to be swayed by this act of self-sacrifice? You will both be stripped of your commissions and will spend 3 years in the stockade.
Judge Helena, 65, with long, white, braided hair and a soft face, touches Ignatius on the shoulder.
I would like to speak.
Ignatius begrudgingly gives her the floor.
Lieutenant, why did you pull a stunt like this? I mean...
Helena ruffles through her screen for information.
You outperformed every candidate in pilot school since your brother.
Cleto lowers her eyes.
Yet you chose the Ministry of Science. Why not the fighter pilot program? With all due respect, ma'am, women are not allowed to fly combat, no matter how good they are. At least in the MOS, there is a possibility of seeing combat.
Ignatius notices this, checks a fact, and the council whispers to each other.
I see. We are all eternally grateful for your brother's bravery and sacrifice in the Kieran Wars.
He looks up the officers.
Clearly, great pilots run in your family. Both of you will be stripped of your officer status and report to the MOS for reassignment of duties.
Judge Ignatius wraps his gavel. Interior, Gorgias' home, evening. Gorgias sits at the dinner table with his grandkids as they eat soup. Suddenly, the whole house shakes, and the sound of Kieran APCs is deafening. Hikarian village. The APCs uncloak over the village, sending the forest animals running for their lives. The APCs blow leaves off the trees. The branches and trunks snap beneath the landing, massive steel structures. Harkarians come out of their home to see what all the commotion is about. The hatch opens, and Kieran troops descend onto the Harkarian streets. An alarm sounds, and several Harkarian militia members dressed in military uniforms come out, armed with clubs and stun guns. They clash with the Kierans in a bloody and quick battle, but the militia is no match for the Kierans and their armor. The militia is quickly defeated and bled dry as the dwarves are kicked and the villagers are dragged out of their homes. A young man tries to run for it, but a Kieran pounces on him before he takes two steps. His throat is ripped open and is sucked dry. In Gorgias' home, the three of them watch in horror as Nyx grips onto Gorgias, sobbing.
Don't let them eat me.
I won't let anything happen to you.
The door is smashed open and a Kieran comes in. He searches, overturning furniture and destroying everything in his path, but finds no sign of Gorgias and the children. In the corner of the room, Gorgias and the children are huddled tightly together. He holds a remote control-sized cloaking device in one hand. The Kieran turns to leave. Nyx shakes with fear and tears and snot drop off his chin. A slight sniffle stops the Kieran, making him perk up his ears and spin around. He sniffs the air, making Gorgias and the children shrink into each other more, until the Kieran is right in front of them. He gives one last sniff and leaves. The three of them sigh with relief.
We'll make our way to the outpost and send a distress beacon.
Gorgias guides the children out the back door. Interior, Kieran mothership. Dragola's chamber. An ornate room with paintings and sculptures of Kieran life. Dragola watches the feeding frenzy and imprisonment of the Arcanians unfold on the large screen. Captain STIBOR enters, wiping red blood off his face and licking greedily at his fingers. He bows before Dragola.
Your Highness, shall I fetch you a fat one? You must be starving.
Dragola turns to face Stibor.
I'm not hungry.
But you must feed, sire.
Dragola regards the glyph-like mosaics portraying the ancient Kirans as human. Then the glyphs show them in spaceships, killing animals, Kiran suffering on a dark and barren landscape. He looks at a portrait of a man that looks like Dragola, except he's human, and there are trees and animals in the background.
My father's greed plunged us into the darkness.
He turns to look at the screen where the carnage continues.
And turned us into the monsters.
Sire, you inherited this disease. If you hadn't called for the exodus of our people, we would have surely perished.
Maybe we should have. State your business.
STIBOR looks around the room nervously.
There's a problem.
STIBOR walks over to the screen where the carnage is unfolding and brings up a schematic of two life forms. One is the humanoid gray and the other is human.
The majority of the Harkarian population is comprised of this gray creature type, whose blood has no nutritional value to us. The other species, while delicious, cannot sustain us for very long.
Exterior, Harkanian outpost. At the top of a mountain, two large doors open, and a large satellite dish pointing to the sky emerges beneath the ground. A few feet away is the control panel, where Regaius programs the beam. Suddenly, this cloaking device sparks and smokes, decloaking them. The Kieran from the house roars at seeing them.
He followed us, Grandfather!
Regaius turns to deal with the Kieran.
Finish the sequence!
Xanthippe picks up a rock and throws it at the Kieran's head, distracting him from Regaius and attacking her. He pounces on her, but she takes the Kieran's dagger and cuts his arm. He screams in pain. Gorgias finishes the sequence, and the satellite fires a distress signal. Interior, Kieran mothership, Dragola's chamber. Dragola and Stibor are still talking when they are held.
Sire, a distress signal was sent from the outpost overlooking the village.
Dragola brings up the outpost on the screen. On the screen, he watches as Xanthippe fights off the Kieran in vain. He disarms her and prepares to sink his fangs into his neck. As Gorgias pleads for her life, Dragola pushes a button.
Wait! I want the three of them alive.
The Kieran stops, and nets all three of them, and begins to drag them away. Back to scene.
Why would you spare them, sire?
They may prove to be useful.
Ministry of Science building, morning. It's a large hexastyle building with Corinthian pillars and a hologram of the four elements at the entrance. Control room. There are several screens overhead that monitor every sector of the known universe. Atlantean techs sit at their workstations, monitoring every transmission that they come across. Suddenly, Gorgias' distress signal is picked up. Atlantean check number one, eyes widen as he looks over the transmission.
By the gods!
The supervisor notices this and approaches.
What is it?
He shows the supervisor as he goes pale.
Inform Dr. Vern immediately.
Science lab, an amphitheater-style laboratory that seats 50. With the laboratory in the center, Dr. Vern, 74, a slight man with white, bushy beard, stands in front of a chemistry experiment. There is a large explosion that is contained within an energy field, no bigger than a basketball. In the audience sits senators, 30 to 75, wearing ceremonial togas over their shiny bodysuits, and military brass, 40 to 60, wearing ceremonial armor over their metallic-colored bodysuits.
And so, in conclusion, we can contain the energy expenditure of a star in a sphere the size of a child's toy, rendering it completely safe.
He takes the energy sphere and bounces it like a ball, making the audience gasp.
Until it is needed.
He tosses it to an old general, who catches it nervously, making the audience laugh and clap. In the hallway, he walks obliviously, studying his tablet with a complicated mathematical equation as his secretary, 20, short and cute, looks over his schedule.
Wonderful job, sir. And your new security detail is waiting for you in your office.
They arrive at Dr. Vern's office, where they come in and Cleo and Ezekiel are seated. He looks up, confused.
Can I help you?
They give him a quizzical look, as Vern's secretary rolls her eyes.
You didn't hear a word I said, did you?
Vern gives his secretary a quizzical look, making her shake her head and leave, closing the door behind her. The three of them look at each other with a, what just happened, look.
Dr. Verne, we've been assigned to your security detail and are at your disposal.
On a large screen, Cleto and Ezekiel's files with their pictures come up.
Very impressive, especially you, Lieutenant Cleto. Aren't you a bit overqualified to babysit an old man like myself?
Cleto and Ezekiel glance at each other and drop their heads as Dr. Verne continues reading, then grimace when he gets to the end.
Ah, I see. Old Iggy sent you to me as a punishment. Well, it's not the kind of your, not the end of your career, as we all make mistakes, even High Judge Ignatius.
Ezekiel lets out a little laugh.
What will our duties entail, sir?
I'm sorry to say, it's pretty boring. Basically, just accompanying me to conferences and making sure I get home before my wife.
Suddenly, Atlantian Tech Number 1 barges in.
Doctor! Kieran's invasion? Icarian's exterminated!
He brings up the distress signal on the big screen. On the screen, GORGIAS at the outpost with Nix and Xanthippe fighting with Kieran.
Kieran forces have broken our planetary defenses, using us as a food source. All is lost.
In the background, the Kieran can be seen rushing GORGIAS, and his screaming can be heard before the message cuts out. Back to scene. The three of them look at each other, dazed.
So much for boring.
Interior, Kieran Mothership, Dragola's chambers. The door slides open, and a sentry shoves GORGIAS and the kids in. Dragola has his back to them, watching the monitor.
I don't want to be eaten.
Fed up, Xanthippe runs up and lunges at Dragola, but he turns and catches her by the throat with lightning speed.
Please, don't hurt my granddaughter.
Dragola puts her down gently.
I do not wish to hurt you, any of you.
Is that what you call draining us like gourds?
He sighs.
It is but the heavy heart that we feed on your people. I take no pleasure in it.
I'm sure.
GORGIAS nudges her.
We desecrated our planet, and in turn corrupted our very DNA, turning us into this.
Are we supposed to pity you?
Dragola narrows his eyes, annoyed.
Please, your highness, continue.
The tense beat.
I wish to spare you and your people. All I ask is that you send another distress signal.
A distress signal?
The kids look at each other, hopeful. GORGIAS noses a stasis chamber and a large machine which fits under a sliding skylight. Dragola sees what he's eyeing and smiles, showing his sharp white fangs.
One of the last relics of our great civilization.
The experiments your scientists performed were deemed criminal.
We ruled absolutely.
A tense beat.
Is that a particle generator?
GORGIAS smiles.
Yes, it is.
Oh, I've heard of them, but to see one in person.
Dragola escorts him to examine it.
It's taken me decades to finally rebuild it.
GORGIAS stares at Dragola, dumbfounded.
It works.
Dragola nods.
Its power can destroy a planet.
Or restore us. So you will send it?
How do we know that you will keep your word?
In an instant, Dragola is an inch from Xanthippe's face, fangs bared.
I could rip you to shreds before you could utter a syllable.
Xanthippe turns white with fear as Dragola stands and cuts the palm of his hands with a sharp nail, extending his hand to GORGIAS.
My blood is my oath. I am bound by it.
GORGIAS extends a shaky hand and grasps Dragola's.
Then it is settled.
Interior, Atlantian military hangar, evening. A massive hangar filled with warships as thousands of troops in full combat gear and carrying firearms file inside in tight formation. Among the troops, a company stands at attention. In front of them is Captain Londo, 25, athletic and attractive.
Today, the Kieran menace has resurfaced, this time attacking planet Harkarian. For their treachery, we will not accept their retreat or surrender.
Londo puts his fist over his heart. His company does the same.
We are the Atlantean Defense Force. The gods have forged us with might and tempered us with wisdom. We pledge our lives to defending the weak, defeating evil, and bringing justice to the universe.
Troops turn and file into their ship.
Captain Londo, a word.
He turns to see Dr. Byrne standing with Plato and Ezekiel and approaches.
Doctor?
This is Lieutenant...
Specialist Plato and Specialist Ezekiel, sir.
Plato, huh?
She nods apprehensively. A tense moment between them.
Well, Plato, you go with Captain Londo and Ezekiel. My boy, you are with me.
With all due respect, Doctor, I don't want her...
No, with all due respect, Captain, this mission technically falls under the Ministry of Science, so I am in charge. And I say Specialist Plato goes with you.
Londo clenches his jaw and regards Plato a moment before spinning his heels and heading to his ship.
Are you coming or what?
Plato and Dr. Byrne exchange a glance. He smiles and motions for her to follow him before he and Ezekiel board their own ship. Exterior, planet Alantia. As the sun is setting, several massive ships breach the water's surface and leave the planet's atmosphere into outer space, where the fleet gets into attack formation with Londo's ship in front and Dr. Byrne's ship at the center. Interior, Dr. Byrne's ship, helm. The helm is comprised of Atlantean crew people, 20 to 30. At the center sits the captain, 50, clean-shaven and hard.
Prepare for hyperdrive in 3, 2.
By the helm's entrance are two jump seats, where a nervous Dr. Byrne and Ezekiel fumble with their seatbelts.
Ready for the hyperspace window?
Dr. Byrne, pale and sweating, rests his head on the seat back and closes his eyes.
Never am.
One!
Outer space, a window appears in front of the fleet as ships race into it, closing behind the last one. Interior, KIERAN mothership, hangar. Several fighters and APCs line the perimeter. It is completely empty, except for DRAGOLA, GORGIAS, and the kids. He leads them towards a small Hikarian craft that is more like an escape pod, and invites them to board. GORGIAS hesitates, but DRAGOLA does his best to give him a convincing smile.
Please, after you.
They all enter the Hikarian ship, where GORGIAS powers it up and types a distress signal and sends it.
It is done.
Good. You're free to go.
He exits the small ship.
What about the rest of our people? Or did you forget about them?
My blood oath was for your freedom, not your entire people. But they will be released in due time as well.
You monster!
Gorgias grabs her.
Silence, child. He is releasing us.
What's stopping him from blowing us to dust as soon as we escape?
Gorgias turns to DRAGOLA for an answer.
You are free to go and will not be harmed by KIERAN hands. My blood is my bond.
Gorgias nods apprehensively and closes the hatch door. Londo's ship, helm. Captain Londo stands watching the main street in front. Plato stands behind him in the small jump seat.
Sir, we've picked up another distress signal. It's from a Hikarian craft.
Triangulate position.
The crewman does so.
Holding orbit on the Hikarian moon.
Excellent. Set new course and prepare rescue procedures.
The crew goes to work.
Captain, how can we be sure it's not just a KIERAN trap?
The message was authenticated. It is Hikarian in nature. Lieutenant.
A beat.
But the KIERANs could have...
The KIERANs' intellect has been rendered barely above an animal's with all the toxicity they have absorbed.
Little clenches her jaw in anger. Outer space. Hikarian moon. The Hikarian ship is in a steady orbit. Inside the craft, Gorgias desperately presses the buttons as Xanthippes removed a panel of circuitry and is looking over it. Nix sits in a corner with his head buried in his knees.
The guidance system won't come back online.
Of course it won't. I bet the life support systems are next. We won't have to worry about the KIERANs drinking us dry when we slowly suffocate.
She slams her fist on the floor.
No, life support is fine. I'll send another message.
He tries the communicator. It is dead. They look out the window and see the KIERAN ships cloaking as the hyperspace window opens.
Oh no.
Outer space. The hyperspace window opens at the Atlantean fleet exits. Inside the Hikarian ship, Gorgias punches the communicator button in vain.
It's a trap! Get out of here! It's a trap!
Outer space. The Atlantean fleet spreads out, securing the perimeter before Dr. Byrne's ship breaks away and approaches the Hikarian ship. Bergaius' craft is being reeled in by the tractor beam when Kieran warships uncloak. In Dr. Byrne's ship, alarms go off and crew members press buttons as the captain barks orders.
Take evasive maneuvers! Raise shields!
Ezekiel turns to Dr. Byrne.
Dr. Byrne?
All Dr. Byrne can do is smile sadly.
I'm sorry, my boy.
Outer space, the Kieran's fire on Dr. Byrne's ship, blowing it up. In Londo's ship, Helm, there's complete mayhem as the crew goes to work to secure the perimeter and prepare for the fight.
Zeke!
Cleo turns to leave.
Where do you think you're going?
Those animals have a date with death, and I aim to deliver. Any objections?
Londo scoffs and returns attention to the helm. Kieran mother's ship, Helm. Captain STIBOR barks orders as the crew mount their assault.
Release the fighters!
DRAGOLA arrives.
Sire, your plan is working just as you said.
DRAGOLA smiles.
Our carrion craft in sight.
Dispose of them.
No!
I gave my blood oath.
DRAGOLA smiles.
We still need them.
Londo's ship, hangar. Pilots rush to their fighters. Cleo's among them. She gets to a fighter, but an Atlantean fighter pilot pushes her away.
Where do you think you're going?
Out of my way, meathead.
He scoffs and starts to climb the fighter's ladder.
You know the rules. No women in combat.
Combat this!
She flushes red with anger and kicks him in the balls, dropping him to the ground in pain. She boards the fighter ship. She ignites the thrusters and gets into the launch line and flies out of the hangar. Londo's ship, Helm. On the screen, Londo notices Plato's fighter outmaneuvering Kieran fighters, destroying one after another. The other Atlantean fighters quickly take her wingman position, giving her the leader position.
Sir, that woman pilot? She's disabled the Kieran's warship cannons.
Londo smiles.
Instruct the squadrons to keep those fighters off her while she takes out their defenses.
Aye, aye, Captain.
Kieran mothership, Helm.
Sire, that pilot is reducing our fighters to nothing.
Regola smiles and nods.
Inform the fleet to hold a position and destroy the Atlantean scum.
But, sire, it will be a slaughter.
That sacrifice is necessary if our race is to survive.
Stiver's eyes widen with horror.
Sire.
Retake the Carcarian ship and set course for the neutral zone, third planet from its star. If they dare to pursue us, it is there we will make our final stand. No more running.
A tear rolls down Stiver's cheek.
Is that understood?
Stiver nods.
Yes, Your Highness.
Outer space, the Kieran warships and fighters hold the Atlantean assault as the Atlanteans advance. In the melee, Dragolar's ship and cloaks moves towards Vergaius' ship and captures it. Cleo's ship breaks away from her assault on the Kieran warship defenses to protect Vergaius' ship, but it's too late. DRAGOLA has taken the ship as Cleo fires at the massive mothership in vain. As soon as the Harkarian ship is on board, the Kieran mothership warps away. Interior, Londo's ship, Helm. The room is in a disarray as crew members extinguish electrical fires and medics tend to the injured. An unconscious Londo stirs awake, holding the gash over his head. He strains to stand up.
Damage report.
On the big screen, glass of the Kieran ships are destroyed or are burning. The debris of countless Atlantean fighters' ships litter space. Of all the fleet ships, Captain Londo's is the last one.
Shields are at 30%. Decks 7 through 15 have been destroyed. 5,000 casualties aboard and counting.
Londo hangs his head.
Hail the other captains.
Crewman turns to Londo with a blank stare.
I'm sorry, sir. You're the only one left.
At this, Captain Londo falls into his captain's chair, in shock. A moment of dazed silence. Then the bridge is hailed.
Sir. Master Chief Presidus is hailing us.
On screen.
On screen, Master Chief Presidus, 50s. His stern face has been scarred by years of battle, leaving him with only one cold blue eye.
Sir.
Master Chief, are you all right?
Presidus takes a moment to assess his surroundings.
Well, my APCs look more like strainers than ships. Half my boys are splattered on the walls. And one of those walking leeches crashed his rust bucket right through my latrine. So to answer your question, no, I'm not all right, sir.
An awkward moment as Lando takes it all in. Then?
And we don't even know where those bastards jumped to.
Not necessarily.
Londo stares at Poseidus, wide-eyed. Interior Londo's ship, brig. The cell door opens and Londo and Poseidus enter a dimly lit room with nothing but a table and a couple of chairs. On one side of the table sits a Kieran pilot shackled to a seat and wounded from battle.
This one didn't have the decency to die before I pulled him out of his cockpit.
Commence recording of Kieran prisoner interrogation.
A chime is heard overhead.
I'm Captain Londo of the Atlantean Armada. You crashed your ship and were pulled out of the craft before you burned to death.
I would have rather died.
Poseidus moves towards the Kieran.
That can still be arranged.
Londo shoots in the glare and Poseidus stands down.
We need your fleet's jump coordinates.
Of course. Anything else? How about my lord's head on a silver platter?
You're going to give me those jump coordinates, choppers, one way or another.
The Kieran laughs heartily.
Or what? You'll inflict pain? Death? We are pain. We are death.
He grins, exposing his fangs.
Tell me.
Poseidus jumps on the Kieran, choking the life out of him.
Master Chief!
Poseidus pays no attention. Londo struggles in vain to pry Poseidus' hands off the Kieran's throat.
We need him to tell us where they went.
He doesn't let go as the Kieran gasps and struggles for air.
Kierans don't talk, Captain. They fight, they eat, and they kill. But they don't talk.
Londo is helpless as the Kieran goes limp.
Captain, move!
Londo turns to see Clyde pointing a stun gun at Poseidus. Londo jumps off Poseidus right before she zaps him and knocks him out. Poseidus collapses to the floor as Londo stares, panting at Clyde. Interior, Kieran mothership, hangar. Regaius' little ship sits between two fighters as Regola stands in front of the entrance. He nods to one of the Kieran crewmen and the open hatch as the Parkarians come spilling out.
You used us as bait, you monster!
She runs up and pummels Regola with all her might, but he just looks at her with pity.
Zan, no!
Before he can reach Zan, Regola picks her up by the back of her shirt like a kitten as she kicks out in vain. In the commotion, Regaius takes the opportunity to attach a small device to the side of the ship, which has a blinking light.
I swore a blood oath to not harm you.
Dragola gently puts her down as she runs into Regaius' arms. He holds his grandchildren tightly.
And here you are, without even a scratch.
A tense moment of silence. Then...
But you let us go, and now...
You are my charge until I say otherwise. Put them with the others.
Dragola begins to walk away, then turns around baring his teeth.
Be grateful, I keep my word.
Londo's ship, break. Londo pats the unconscious Kieran's face.
Hey, wake up.
The Kieran's eyes flutter open. Looking dazed, he looks from Londo to Cleto and the unconscious Poseidus, slumped on the floor.
Give me your ship's jump coordinates.
I know nothing.
Londo grits his teeth.
Tell me.
The Kieran lets out a maniacal laugh as Londo punches him in the face, making the Kieran laugh even harder.
Without your ships, you are just as helpless as any other meat sack.
Londo raises his arm again to strike him, and Cleto stops him. Instead, she calmly sits across from the Kieran.
I'm Specialist Cleto, and I'm here to talk to you. Do you understand?
Both the Kieran and Londo look at each other, confused. The Kieran nods, unsure.
You're right. We are fragile and weak, and without our technology, we are as helpless as the Harkarians.
The Kieran chuckles.
But this meat sack just saved your life. And I invoke the Verkhalaic Oath.
The Kieran stops chuckling. Londo opens his mouth to speak, but she shoots him a shut-up glance.
But the Var...
can be invoked by anyone. Is your word not your bond?
The Kieran bares his fangs and howls in anger as Cleo sits across from the Kieran, grinning. After a moment, the Kieran goes silent and bows his head in acknowledgement.
I ask for your fleet's jump coordinates.
I see to your request.
And when you've given me the jump coordinates,
she bows slightly,
I release you of your bond.
The Kieran bows slightly in return. In the hallway, Vida walks quickly, smiling triumphantly. Londo, still confused, walks behind her.
Wait up.
She continues to walk.
Cleto, stop.
She stops and stands at attention, doing her best to hide her smile.
Yes, Captain?
What was that?
You mean the Varkolaic Oath?
The what oath?
Plato frowns.
If you save a Kieran's life, they're bound by honor to return the favor.
Where did you learn that?
She shrugs. My emphasis was on cultural studies and rituals at the Academy.
Londo smiles and nods.
Well done, Lieutenant.
He continues walking as Plato's smiles widen. Kieran mothership, her carrion holding cell. A couple of Kieran guards open up the sliding door to reveal the remaining few thousand Harkarians. There are cries and gasps of fears at the sight of the Kierans. Then Gorgias and the kids are pushed in. The three of them face the rest of their people. Gorgias' friend, Madras, emerges from the crowd, shaken, and falls into Gorgias' arms.
Madras!
He steadies himself, and he just looks into Gorgias' eyes and shakes his head.
I laughed at you.
Don't trouble yourself.
We called you an old fool, and I laughed at my best friend.
Murmurs of unrest begin to stir in the crowd. Gorgias grabs Madras by the arms and shakes him a bit.
Now is not the time to assign blame, old friend. We have to stay calm and alert if we are to survive. Understand?
Madras nods in agreement. Kieran mothership. Dragola's chamber. Dragola stands over a cylindrical chamber with pale and beautiful woman inside. Her eyes are closed as she lies, motionless. Dragola runs a finger across the glass, her face.
My dearest Mina.
He rests his head on the glass.
How I long to hold you again, my love.
He looks up at one of the paintings on the wall. In the painting stands a younger and human-looking Dragola with Mina, both wearing tiaras. In front of them sit an older man and woman wearing large crowns. The background is a castle surrounded by a lush green forest. Back to scene. Dragola looks at the chamber. A tear rolls down his cheek.
I have found a way to bring you back, my love.
Just then the door chimes.
What?
A beat?
We've gotten word that the Atlanteans are in pursuit.
Dragola opens the door and lands Cyborg in.
And?
It is as you predicted, sire. They are alone.
Dragola smirks.
Thank you, Captain.
Stibor salutes him and leaves. Londo's ship, bridge. The fires are out, the power has been restored. Londo sits in his chair while Plato wears her lieutenant bars and turns on him.
You're going to do what?
If we don't take the chance to hunt them down now, they may elude our grasp again.
With all due respect, Captain, we are in no condition to pursue the enemy.
I will decide what condition we're in.
Plato takes a deep breath and approaches him.
Londo, our long-range comms are out. Half of our arsenal is gone, along with our troops. Don't be foolish.
Londo's face reddens and he stands.
How many times have those leeches attacked a planet and hid before we could come to the rescue? Planet after planet, finding entire species extinct because of their hunger.
I've analyzed every scenario, and we cannot win.
That's what I told my squadron leader when we faced the entire Kieran Armada.
Plato winces at this.
He struck me across the face and told me to return to the barracks if I was afraid.
Plato grits her teeth.
There is a difference between fear and hubris, a lesson my brother learned too late.
How dare you?
The Harkarians are probably already dead, and you want to...
Captain, we're receiving a Harkarian distress signal.
Both Lon and Plato regard each other.
Point of origin?
In the neutral zone.
Well, Lieutenant?
A beat.
Let's finish this.
Exterior, Earth's orbit. Out of the blackness, the massive Kieran mothership comes out of warp drive and hovers over Earth. Interior, Kieran mothership, bridge. Dragola is lost in thought as he regards the blue planet in front of him.
Your Highness, we're awaiting orders.
Dragola comes to.
Initiate operations and begin descent.
The helmsman nods and prepares. In the holding cell, Gorgias and the rest of the Arcanians huddle together. The ship begins to shake violently as it enters the Earth's atmosphere. Everyone screams in fear as Gorgias holds his grandchildren tightly. Exterior, ancient Mesopotamia, 3000 BC, day. A vast valley laden with fertile green fields and a river flowing through it. Farmers tend to the fields and grazing livestock as elegantly robed men oversee the work and ride chariots. Nearby, stands a high-walled city made of mortar and brick, as spear-carrying troops patrol the perimeter of the main gates. In the fields, men and women, young and old, work the fields. Martyr 17, broad-shouldered and good-looking, is among them as he cuts down barley with a scythe. He works alongside his father, Boaz, 40, thin and sickly. Nazir, 35, fat and wearing elegant priest's robes, rides his chariot as two horseback bodyguards flank him. Nasir steps off his chariot and observes the workers, making Martyr scoff.
Bite your tongue, boy, lest you want to bring attention to yourself.
That bloated pig has never done an honest day's work, and he stands over us like his property.
Like God saw fit to make him the high priest. And they saw fit to make you a farmer's son.
Nasir spots a beautiful young girl, 15, working alongside her mother, 35, and approaches them.
Good afternoon, my dear.
The young girl stops working and faces Nasir, eyes cast down. He caresses her face.
Such a beautiful child. Is she yours?
Her mother nods, afraid.
The gods have spoken, and they desire you.
The girl looks at her mother, pleading.
Your sacrifice will ensure that the harvest will be plentiful.
Why is it that only beautiful girls are chosen by the gods?
The young girl now begins to cry as Nasir pulls her towards his chariot. Her mother pulls at the girl's arm in vain, crying.
If the gods see this as fit, then I spit on them in their will.
He spits.
You will damn us all.
Look around, father. We're already damned.
Marduk approaches Nasir.
Good day, priest.
Nasir stops and regards Marduk.
Greetings to you, Marduk, son of Boaz. I see you have healed well from your wounds.
Marduk looks down at the deep, long scar running down his arm.
Small price to pay for His Highness's victory in the battlefield. Lucky for you, priests are excluded from military service.
Nasir's face reddens.
I assure you, the gods are appeased.
And your brother's fortunate to have such an emissary.
The bodyguards stiffen and poise their spears.
Watch your tongue, farmer, lest you wish lose it.
How odd that the gods never demand one of your kin as a sacrifice.
Nasir motions to the guards to attack Marduk. Even though they tower over Marduk, he is quick and agile. He bears his scythe into one of their necks and impales the other with his own spear. Nasir hops onto his chariot and tries to make a run for it, but Marduk throws a spear at one of the wheels, shattering it and knocking Nasir to the ground. Marduk picks up the scythe again and approaches a blubbering Nasir.
Please! Have mercy!
Perhaps the gods demand your blood as a sacrifice.
Just then, an arrow hits the ground next to Marduk. He turns to see an entire battalion with drawn swords and poised archers. Marduk regards Nasir, bullets, and raises his arms in surrender. Then, the sky roars as if it's been torn open, and a fireball descends from the sky, which sends soldier and farmer alike running for cover back to the city. All except Marduk, who stares at the Kieran's ship in disbelief. Begin montage. In the walled city, Mesopotamians reinforce the city gates, as old women cry and plead for mercy to the gods. On the Atlantean ship, the remaining troops and crew stand in formation as coffins are arranged in rows. They are shot out into space, one by one, as Londo speaks their names. M.O.S. The Kieran ship lands in a clearing, scorching the ground beneath it. The door opens and Kieran gliders holding armor-clad Kierans fly out, headed for the city. Outside of the city, Marduk bangs on city gates to be let in. But he is pelted with rocks and garbage until he flees into the wilderness, scared and alone. On the Atlantean ship, the ceremony continues as Londo pins commander bars and Cleto's lapels, and they all salute her as she fights back her tears, saluting them back. In the walled city, the temple is crowded as the people tug at Nasir's robes in fear and desperation. His guards can do little to keep them back. Just then, Kirans drop into the city, slaughtering and corralling everyone in their path. The soldiers are no match for the Kirans, and they are broken and dry. In the temple, the people cower and throw Nasir to the Kirans. He raises his hands and bows before them. The Kiran in front of him stops and regards him curiously.
I am Nasir, your servant and high priest of the temple of...
The Kiran plunges his hand into Nasir's chest and removes his heart. And he eats it. The rest of the people scream. Above Earth's orbit, the Atlantean ship comes out of warp drive. On the bridge sits Londo in the captain's chair. Cleto stands next to him, barking orders at the crew. In space, the Atlantean ship begins its descent to Earth. End of montage. On the moon, a squadron of Kieran fighter ships powers up their engines to get behind the Atlantean ship. Interior, exterior, Londo ship, bridge, outer space. Everyone braces as they pass through Earth's atmosphere.
Hold her steady!
Commander, Kieran's behind us!
Outside, the Kierans unload their arsenal, causing severe damage.
Fire back!
I can't, Captain. Our rear cannons are still down.
Divert life support power to rear shields.
If we do that, we'll lose stabilizers and crash.
The ship is rattled with impact after impact. Plato thinks for a moment, then...
Overload the warp drive and eject it.
They all stop and look at her.
But Commander, then we'll surely never return home.
If you don't do it, we're dead for sure.
Londo and Plato exchange a determined glance.
You heard the Commander.
Interior, Kieran, squadron leadership.
Move into tight formation. We end this Atlantean nuisance once and for all.
Interior, exterior, Londo ship, bridge, outer space. The Kieran ships move in tight. On Londo's bridge, Cleto watches on screen as the Kierans finish getting into formation.
Now!
Outside, the warp drive is ejected from the Atlantean ship. The Kieran formation fires at the warp drive, making it implode, causing it to form a black hole and sucking the squadron in and any debris around it. It is so powerful that Londo's ship is now slowing down. Inside, Londo grips the arms of his chair.
Give her more power!
That's all she's got, Captain.
I hope you know what you're doing.
Me too.
Outside Londo's ship, there is a tug of war between the black hole and Earth's gravity.
We'll be torn apart!
The crewman moves to get out of the sea.
Hold fast or we all die!
He remains and keeps the engines at their current setting. Suddenly, the black hole implodes on itself, returning space to peaceful blackness. But the ship is now heading towards Earth at full speed. Interior, Londo ship, bridge. The bridge is shaking itself apart.
Reverse engines, full power.
She won't survive atmospheric entry.
Engine failure is imminent.
Not yet. Come on, baby. One last ride.
Exterior, ancient Mesopotamia day. In the forest hills above the city, a scared Marduk watches the city burn as terrified people are marched out through the gates towards the Kieran ship. The Atlantean ship falls like a meteor across the Mesopotamian sky. Interior, Kieran mothership, Arcanian holding cell. GORGIAS still holds his grandchildren tightly as they all wait nervously for something to happen. Then, a large door slides open, letting in the bright sun. Arcanians gasp and shield their eyes. After a moment of shock, GORGIAS stands up and moves towards the door and onto the Kieran camp. He steps onto the ground and flinches at the sight of a line of Kierans standing at attention. But DRAGOLA also stands there and motions for them to come forward. GORGIAS in turn motions for the Arcanians to exit the ship. One by one, they exit the ship and huddle together.
Today marks the beginning of a new era. An era where Harkarians do not fear Kierans. No Kieran hand will harm you again.
There is mumbling and distrusting looks among the Arcanians.
My word is my bond. Go forth and live in peace.
They cautiously walk away, never taking their eyes off Gregola and the Kierans. Greek islands. A massive Atlantean ship crashes onto the sea, causing a tsunami unlike any before. Entire islands are swallowed up, never to be seen again. On the ocean floor, the ship finally comes to a rest. Then, Atlantean personnel begin to swim out of the escape hatches, having no trouble breathing underwater. Londo and Cleto are the last to exit. Then, the hangar door opens, and APCs and fighter ships exit the ship to head for the surface. On the surface, Atlanteans swim out and jump out of the water with joy at being alive. Dolphins approach them and they play, swim, and jump together. The APCs and fighter ships beach themselves in the sand as Londo calls all his personnel to form ranks. Mesopotamian hillside, their companions charge through the forest, trying to get as much distance between them and the Kierans. Below, they see the enslaved Mesopotamians being led back to the ship.
Those poor creatures.
Better than them us.
How long do you think they will keep the Kierans fed? Who do you think will be on the menu when they're extinct?
Their companions mumble and give her reproachful glares.
Take care not to let this one's mouth run too far, old friend. Talk like that can mean excommunication from our new home.
Zan regards him with disdain. The snapping of the blade makes them all jump, revealing Marduk, angry and scared, holding a scythe.
Why have you done this?
Unable to understand him, D'Artagnan's jumped back, shrieking at his sudden appearance. Except for Zan.
Hey, you still have that sonic modulator on you?
Nyx produces a thin remote control and points it at Mordeaux. He yells and raises his scythe.
Wait, don't!
Mordeaux stops.
I can understand you.
Nyx sighs in relief.
Well, of course you can.
10 speed.
Why have you done this? Have we not sacrificed enough children to appease you?
Nyx jumps back as the rest of them regard Mordeaux with utter horror. He kneels.
My gods! Please do not punish my people for my insolence.
The guy steps forward.
We are not gods, young man. We are taken prisoners, like you.
Mordeaux thinks it over for a moment.
Then I will give myself to them and appease the gods' wrath.
Their hands glance at each other awkwardly.
They are not gods either.
Mordeaux regards them with utter confusion.
But you came from the heavens. Then what news do you bring from them?
Gorgias shrugs.
If there are gods, my boy, I have never met one.
Then the other ball of fire that fell from the heavens.
Gorgias and the kids look at each other.
Grandpa, do you think the Atlanteans pick up the distress signal?
Gorgias hugs him.
Maybe so, Nyx. Maybe so.
A beat. Then Mordeaux drops his scythe and approaches Gorgias with his hand outstretched.
I am Mordeaux. Son of Boaz.
Gorgias steps forward, mimicking Mordeaux.
I'm Gorgias. These are my grandchildren, Nyx and Xanthippe. We come from the planet Harkarian.
Mordeaux collapses Gorgias' forearm and shakes it.
Welcome.
Gorgias and the rest of our Arcanians relax. Then Nyx grabs his belly.
Grandpa, I'm hungry.
Gorgias looks from his grandson to the rest of them and realizes how hungry they are.
Would you help us find food?
Mordeaux smiles and nods.
Of course. Follow me.
Atlantean crashlight. On the beach, Atlantean crew members prepare the APCs and fighter ships, while troops and fighter pilots come together for a briefing. In the briefing area, Brasidas stands next to a 3D hologram projector, showing an image of Earth.
Those leeches landed right around here. As of right now, this is still a rescue mission. Our primary concern is rescuing the Harkarians.
Londo steps next to Brasidas.
Gentlemen, I don't have to tell you the gravity of our situation. We are low on power and ammo.
A line from their camp to the Carrion crash site appears.
We are approximately 1,200 clicks west of our engagement point. Ground forces will lead the invasion, as fighters will provide air support.
There may be more of them, but we are better trained and have the element of surprise. Good luck to you all.
Brasidas salutes Londo, prompting everyone else to salute. He salutes back before walking away. Kieran Mothership, Hangar, the Kieran's feast on helpless humans. On a landing above, DRAGOLA watches with disgust as human screams echo into the hall. STIBOR comes over and watches the carnage next to him. STIBOR smiles as his face is smeared with fresh blood.
Such bounty and taste.
In the hangar, a man breaks free from the Kieran's grasp and makes a run for the opening, but knocks himself out on the invisible force field. Back to scene. STIBOR laughs heartily at this.
And stupid to boot.
STIBOR regards DRAGOLA and his small fates as he watches the carnage in disgust.
You do not look well, sire. When did you last eat?
I'm not hungry.
DRAGOLA turns and exits. In DRAGOLA's chamber, Mina lays in her stasis chamber as DRAGOLA storms in. He approaches her chamber and enters a sequence on his keypad. The hatch above slides open, hitting both of them with a ray of sunlight. Another few strokes on the keypad, and a tube of black liquid rises out of her compartment. He works quickly, taking the syringe and drawing from the black liquid. He enters another sequence, and the chamber opens. Just as he does, Mina begins to crack and decompose. DRAGOLA injects her quickly, and the decomposition stops. He enters another sequence on the keypad, and a red button lights up.
Come back to me, my love.
He presses the red button, and electricity courses through her as the sun rays hit her, snapping her eyes open, arching her back, convulsing and screaming. The electricity stops, and so does she, as DRAGOLA watches, hopeful. Her cracked and rotting skin start to heal as she takes a deep breath and flutters her eyes open. He steps into the darkness so she can't see him. She stretches and sits up.
My love?
Yes.
She looks around.
What is this place?
He appears, still cloaked in the shadows.
Why do you stand in the dark?
Because I will frighten you.
She chuckles and gets off the chamber.
Don't be silly.
She approaches him, but he hides his face with his cape. Her small face, as she covers her nose.
Why does this place reek of death?
A lot has happened, my love.
She runs into his arms and sees him. She shrieks, stumbling back into the light, speechless.
What?
Please calm down, my love.
She takes a deep breath and steels herself.
Everything I knew is gone, isn't it?
Yes.
And we are not on Kieran.
The girl slowly approaches, shaking his head. Flashback, planet here in the capital. A booming, industrial, high metropolis spreads through a valley. At the center, on a mound, stands a large metal tower, its spires and turrets. The king from the paintings watches as the sky is dark with smog.
As the demand for weapons increased in the galaxy, Father was more than happy to oblige.
Outer space. Kieran warships attack each other, destroying and evading each other. One set are white with red insignias on their tails, while the other are gunmetal, gray with yellow markings on their wings. In the city.
His wealth grew exponentially, but at a terrible cost.
It is dirty as people work manufacturing weapons and warships. Forested valley.
Father's greed poisoned the water and air.
A beautiful valley full of trees, streams, and mountains. It's teeming with wildlife. Then, giant machines fly overhead, raising the ground bare. The machines expand and begin to mine metal from the underground. In no time, the colored water running in the stream turns into a black sludge. Animals and fish choke and die. Country palace.
And when I asked questions, he gave me weak answers.
It is a beautiful white tower where nature is still pristine. Mina and the courtiers sit under a tree, picnicking. Dragola-looking human sneaks up behind them and wraps his arms around Mina, biting her neck, then gently kissing her pregnant belly. She and the other ladies giggle.
I turned a blind eye until it was too late.
He sees his father convoy approaching. The ships look damaged. He kisses her and tells the ladies, MOS, to continue their picnic. In the king's quarters, the king sits at his desk as chests of gold and jewels sit next to him. Dragola bursts in, red with anger.
How could you?
The king rises and smiles defiantly.
Hello, son.
You sold the same warships to the Frisians and Progarians. The Atlanteans will call for sanctions, maybe even an embargo.
The king comes over to Dragola.
They will do no such thing.
Father, this is blatant warmongering. The council will take action.
If they do, I will halt all coalition forces, armaments, immediately. Let's see them protect the universe with their Atlantean water guns.
In the capital, people are sick and dying in the streets. They try to leave the city, but the military won't let them. The two sides clash, leaving dead civilians to rot where they died.
Not only had his greed poisoned our world, it had poisoned our people, too.
In the sewers, a man trudges through the sewers. He goes up a ladder and pushes open the storm drain and enters a hangar, where the king's ship is preparing to take off. The scared and sick man makes his way to the landing gear and grabs on for dear life. In the moment, the ship's engines power on and it takes off. He goes unnoticed by the ground crew and guards. The capital. It is chaos as factory workers fire half-finished artillery at the king's ship and his convoy, damaging them. On the king's ship, the man holds on as the landing gear is stowed, and he is safely inside. Country palace. The ship's landing gear deploys as they reach the palace. The ships speed over a large lake as they prepare to land. The man, tired and dirty, lets himself fall close to the shore, where Mina and the ladies are sitting.
Your kindness and bravery sealed your fate.
The man flails in the water, catching Mina's attention. She dives in and pulls the man out. He's not breathing. The courtiers are frozen with fear, but she gives him mouth to mouth and he coughs up the water. Just then, royal guard crafts touch down and take the man away. Mina's bedroom evening. Mina's sick and coughing. Dragola sits at her side, holding her hand and crying.
When the plague came, you were one of its first casualties outside of the city.
In the courtyard, people lay dead and dying. Exterior king's balcony. The king, also sick, stands watching the setting sun as Atlantean and coalition ships fire on Kieran ground forces and ships. Dragola, showing signs of fever, approaches his father.
Your grandson has died in childbirth.
The king, lost in thought, turns with a sad smile to Dragola and jumps off the balcony to his death. Dragola stands alone, watching the invading forces advancing.
The few hundred of us that survived became this, surviving off of blood like parasites.
Back to scene. Mina listens to Dragola with tears streaming down her cheeks.
I have moved mountains and waited centuries to look into your eyes again.
She approaches him and slowly takes his hand in hers.
Centuries?
He nods sadly.
Then wait no more, my love.
She takes his face in her hand and kisses him. Exterior, Harkarian camp, evening. In a clearing, makeshift shelters have been erected out of sticks and leaves as a large bonfire burns in the center. A large carcass cooks over the flame as Marduk breathes in the aroma and sighs. The Harkarians, though, cover their noses with disgust. GORGIAS, Nix, and Zen enter the camp holding forged nuts, berries, and roots.
What is that awful smell?
I believe it is burning flesh.
Nix shudders.
Barbaric.
In the distance, Atlantean crafts come in low and fast. In Cleo's craft, Cleo sits at the command chair.
Run a scan to see if the Kierans have changed position.
Negative.
Then let's end this once and for all.
Commander, we're getting a unique Harkarian signature within the assault kill zone.
On screen.
On the screen shows Marduk offering GORGIAS and Madras a leg of lamb, and Madras turning and vomiting. Back to scene.
Get me a secure channel.
Crewman number one punches a couple of buttons.
Commander's broadcasting.
Abort assault. I repeat, abort assault.
Interior London's craft. Londo gets out of his chair.
This better be good, Commander.
Is finding the surviving Harkarians good enough? Sending Harkarian coordinates now, sir.
Looks of surprise as crewmen whisper to each other, impressed.
You got something to say?
The crewman stands at attention.
It's just, she's kind of amazing, sir.
Yes, she is.
Exterior, Harkarian camp. In the makeshift camp, the Harkarians breathe the first sigh of relief in a long time. Then, there's a rustle in the bushes, and the sound of military boots breaking branches startles them. Marduk reaches for his sword. As Londo and Atlantean troops emerge from the bush, Marduk pounces Londo, knocking the weapon out of his hands. Residus swings his rifle like a club at Marduk, but he is more adept to fighting in close quarter combat and cracks Residus' head bloody with the butt of his sword. GORGIAS and the Harkarians recognize the new foes.
Marduk, they're friends.
Another soldier fires, nearly hitting Londo, and Marduk slashes at him, cutting the shoulder strong. Marduk grabs Londo and puts a sword to Londo's throat.
Leave this place, or die like your leader.
Suddenly, Marduk falls to the ground, unconscious, revealing Cleo standing behind him, holding a rock in her hand. Kieran, mother's ship. Dragola's chamber. Dragola and Mina lie naked in bed, covered by a sheet. Just then, the chamber door slides open, and STIBOR enters.
Your Highness, the troops are full and...
He stares, mouth agape as Mina smiles at him.
STIBOR?
STIBOR drops to one knee.
My queen!
She lets out a tiny giggle.
Get up, old friend.
He does so, and does his best to wipe his bloody mouth.
But how...
My love, I would love to see our people.
Both STIBOR and Dragola exchange a nervous glance.
All in good time, my love.
You are needed on the bridge, sire.
In the hallway, Dragola and STIBOR walk.
Mina, she looks...
I found the cure, old friend. The key was this planet's sun.
STIBOR stops, shocked.
But what of the prisoners?
We can go back to being like we were. After centuries of searching, we can be Kieran again.
Beat.
What if our people like the way they are now? Strong, fast, ruthless.
Dragola stop, scoffs.
When they see their queen.
With all due respect, sire, I fear for the queen's safety and her condition.
Dragola regards STIBOR for a moment.
Perhaps you're right. We will keep this between us for now.
Dragola puts his hand on Stibor's shoulder.
Thank you for your counsel and your friendship.
STIBOR nods.
Of course, sire.
STIBOR does his best to smile as he walks away. His smile fades, and he clenches his jaw in anger. Mesopotamian hillside, night. Marduk lies on the Atlantean stretcher, receiving medical attention from the medic as he starts awake. He opens his eyes and tries to jump off the stretcher, but he is tied to it, writhing and screaming. Gorgias, Londo, and Plato come running to him.
You are safe. They are friends.
Marduk stops struggling and eyes them cautiously.
They too are fallen gods?
Plato and Londo exchange a curious glance.
They have come to fight the fallen ones.
He relaxes and nods.
Then, I thank you for your aid. Apologies, I did not know who you were.
Just then, Brasidas walks up with a banged head.
You're pretty spry there, savage.
You're just upset because he bested you.
Brasidas scoffs.
And because Clato bested him.
A lucky hit.
He turns and leaves as Londo, Gorgias, and Clato stifle a smile. In the camp, the Atlanteans intermingle with the Arcarians, and Gorgias, Madras, Londo, Clato, and Brasidas squat down as Marduk draws out the position with a stick on the ground.
The gods, the Kierans, are located here.
He draws an X in the dirt.
We are here.
He draws another X in the dirt.
We have the cover of night and the trees.
No, we don't. Their night vision is as good as yours or mine is in the day.
He stares, surprised.
Do we know if their thermal scanners and motion sensors are still operational?
Gorgias looks from them, then to the ground.
What's wrong?
They have a particle regenerator, and it works.
Everyone stares, dumbfounded.
But we destroyed them all in the Great War.
Gorgias shakes his head.
What does he mean to do with it?
Probably destroy the planet with all of us on it.
They all look at each other for a moment.
Well, let's hope that's not the case.
Exterior, Kieran camp, night. By the ship, Kierans continue to feast on the dead and dying humans as their moans and screams echo in the forest. A large pyre burns as Kierans throw corpses onto it. In the forest is a clearing where four Kieran officers, gray-haired and battle-scarred, huddle around. The sound of a breaking twig turns their attention towards the noise, with bare, barred fangs. Out of the brush comes STIBOR.
Is all this secrecy really necessary?
Our very futures depend on it, Colonel.
The Colonel's smirk fades. STIBOR has their undivided attention.
We command the Kieran armed forces, beholden only to Dragola. We have fought and bled for him with absolute obedience, but I can no longer after what I learned today.
A Kieran major with bushy white mustache brows.
Choose your words wisely, Captain, or I might make them your last.
He used a particle regenerator to bring the Queen back.
They all stare, mouth agape at him.
Such lies.
I saw her with my own eyes, General. Talking and breathing as you are now. Well, not like you or I.
This is wonderful news. The Queen's returns.
She's not like us.
A beat.
She's like we used to be.
He found a cure?
And he means to restore us.
The officers exchange surprised glances.
I don't know about you, but I like what we are.
He strikes a tree, knocking it down, and lifts his unharmed fist.
And on this planet, we can rule and feed for centuries to come.
This is madness. Dragola is our king.
The others turn their attention on him as STIBOR walks towards him.
How much have we endured because of the Dracul? We can end this, old friend.
The general looks down, torn.
I served his father. I sacrificed my family.
STIBOR smiles.
When he engages the particle regenerator, I will reverse the polarity and make us even stronger. What do you think our people will do when they learn he meant to weaken us?
They will tear him limb from limb.
A tense beat.
Once we start this, there's no turning back.
They all look at each other, nodding in agreement. Harkarian camp. The children laugh at the games. Nix plays with a couple of kids as the bullies approach. Nix braces for a confrontation.
Hey. Can we play too?
Nix smiles and nods. Sitting alone by a fire, sits Zan, lost in thought. She turns her attention to the footsteps behind her to reveal Gorgias coming and sitting down next to her. He regards the children playing.
You didn't want to play?
She shakes her head without looking at him. They see Nix laughing and playing with the other children.
Look at your brother.
I'm happy for him.
I wish I could give you back your childhood.
The beast.
What is the plan of attack?
Well, the Atlanteans are going to attack at first light, and when they win, we can all live happily, in peace.
What about us?
What about us?
What are we doing to help?
Staying out of the way.
She scoffs and stands.
After everything we have lost, you still refuse to take a stand against those monsters?
Her Gaius stands.
We are inventors and thinkers, not warriors. That is the way it has always been.
Wake up, Grandfather. That worked when we still had a planet.
She storms off, leaving Gaius puzzled. In the Atlantean military camp, early morning, it is still dark, as Atlantean troops assemble and prepare to board their APCs. Fighter crafts hover above in a holding position, awaiting strike orders. Marduk watches in awe and fear at the sights and sounds of their weapons and crafts. Londo motions for Marduk to join him. In the APC, Londo gives Marduk a hand in.
Where is Cleato?
He smirks.
You like her, don't you?
Marduk blushes.
Don't worry, she has that effect on all of us.
Is she not coming?
Londo points to the fighters above them.
Hurry up there. Return to base to lead the squadron.
Marduk gives him a confused look. Just then, the APC's engines power up.
You might want to hold on to something.
It takes off, and Marduk grabs onto Londo for dear life.
I meant the rail.
Cleo's fighter. She wears a helmet and flight gear.
Hera to Olympus. Do you copy?
Olympus reads you loud and clear.
Squadron holding and awaiting your signal.
Copy that. Stand by.
In the APC, Marduk follows Plato's voice, and Londo smirks.
Looks like somebody wanted to tell you something.
Londo turns to Marduk and cocks his head towards the mic.
Good hunting, Cleator.
A beat.
You too, Marduk.
Interior Kieran Mothership Bridge. The Kieran crew sit at the controls, monitoring the screens, when a blip reveals the Atlantean ships approaching.
Code red! Code red! Atlanteans approaching!
Exterior Kieran camp. The ship's hangar door opens, and all the Kieran fighter crafts fly out. On the ground, the door opens, and Kieran troops march out and take defensive positions. In the sky, Atlantean and Kieran fighter craft clash as they fire and destroy each other. The Atlanteans are better pilots and have more maneuverable ships. One by one, the Kieran ships are blown out of the sky. On the ground, Atlantean troops clash with the Kierans. An Atlantean fires three rounds into a Kieran's chest, but his armor takes up most of the damage. The Kieran shoulder picks up the Atlantean by the neck and tears his throat out. Londo sees this and stares in disbelief.
Order the troops to aim for the head!
Brasidas is locked in combat with the Kieran. The Kieran has Brasidas by the neck and slams him against a tree.
Your skull will be a great trophy.
Brasidas fumbles for his dagger.
Not today!
And plunges it up through the Kieran's gullet.
Aim for the head! And use those daggers, men!
A Kieran lunges at an Atlantean, but just as he fires right between the Kieran's eyes, dropping him dead on the ground. Amidst all the chaos, Marduk sneaks into the Kieran mothership corridor that is guarded by a sentry. Beyond the sentry, he can hear the echoing moans of his people. He hides and makes a sound, like a mouse, catching the sentry's attention. He comes over to investigate. When he doesn't find Marduk, he goes to return to his post. Marduk buries his sword in the sentry's neck. The sentry drops and dies, gurgling. In the holding area, the sound of the door being unlocked throws everyone into a panic until they see Marduk wearing the Kieran's bloody armor and panting, motioning for them to escape. In Dragola's chamber, the sound of fighting can be heard as he holds Mina's hand.
Are you sure this is what you want? We will lose the battle for sure.
If we are cured, then we can begin the road to peace.
Mina nods and caresses his face.
All right, my love.
He presses a few buttons and the particle regenerator powers up as the activation button lights up.
Every Kieran wearing their armor will be affected.
Dragola moves to his bed, where his armor lays, and puts it on.
Now we are ready.
Suddenly the door opens, and STIBOR and his conspirators rush in, grabbing Mina and holding the bullet at gunpoint.
Forgive me, Your Highness.
What is the meaning of this?
I will not let you lose the war for us.
With lightning speed, Dragola disarms the colonel, who holds his gun at Dragola, and tears his throat out. But the major readies to kill Mina, stopping Dragola in his tracks.
Such speed! Such strength! And you want to take it all away from us?
What good is all this power if there is no peace?
In the sky, The Atlantean fighters have taken control of the sky as the last Kieran fighter falls to the ground in flames. In Clato's ship.
Hera 1 to Olympus. The sky is clear. All leeches have been neutralized.
That's great, but can we get some air support here?
On her screen, she sees the Atlanteans are being overrun by the Kierans.
Hera 1 to Pantheon Squadron. Target Kieran ground forces.
Exterior Kieran camp. Kierans throw and kill Atlanteans left and right as the Atlantean squadron dives into the tree line, strafing Kieran onslaught. Several hundred Kierans drop dead, but hundreds more keep coming. The Atlantean squadron prepares for another run. Plato's ship?
Fire at will! I repeat, fire at will!
We can! We'll hit our troops as well!
In the background, Clato can hear Atlanteans dying.
We better get in that fight or we won't have anybody left.
But you heard the captain.
We land and fight.
Aye, aye, Commander.
Harkarian camp. Gaius and the rest of the Harkarians watch and hear as the sounds of war echo throughout the trees. Zan clenches her jaws in anger, stands up, and picks up an Atlantean dagger left behind.
Zan, put that down.
She regards her grandfather and the rest of the Harkarians.
We have lived in peace because we were under the protection of the Atlantean armada. But those screams and explosions are them, dying.
Concerned mumbles from the crowd.
If we do not help them now, there's no chance they will win.
This is blasphemy. Gaius, control your granddaughter.
On our planet, perhaps, but not here. If we are to survive, we must fight.
The mumbling gets louder and turns into arguing.
Who's with me?
A beat, then...
I'm with you.
Nyx, no.
But Nyx stands beside his sister. Then the bullies and the rest of the young Harkarians, 15 to 30, stand with Xanthippe. There is a clear division between young and old.
This is our home now. And we will help protect it at all costs.
The young Harkarians cheer and rally. In the Kieran camp, afternoon, the fight is all around the Kieran mothership, as three Atlanteans die for every Kieran. Then Clato and the pilots charge the Kierans, pushing them back. Clato, armed with a saber, slashes, parries, dodges, and slashes through Kierans as she runs towards Londo. Londo is bleeding and bruised, but still fighting.
Captain!
As Londo looks, a Kieran lunges at him. Clato throws her saber, piercing the Kieran's breastplate, then dropping him dead at Londo's feet.
Commander, we can't hold the line.
He nods to Poseidus, who lies dead a few feet away. Clato looks from Poseidus to Londo. She slaps him across the face.
You will hold the line, even if you are the last one left! We make our final stand, here.
Londo nods in understanding as they turn to face the Kieran onslaught. Just then, a rock sails through the air, hitting a Kieran in the face, then another and another. Zan, Nyx, and the entire Harkarian people charge out of the brush with sticks and rocks. The Kierans run at the Harkarians but crash into an electric five force field. Behind the charging Harkarians, Gorgias pushes buttons and moves levers on a machine. He and Clato lock eyes, Gorgias smiles and nods. Interior Kieran mothership, Dragola's chamber. Dragola and STIBOR are in the middle of their standoff. STIBOR moves towards the button and pushes it, but nothing happens.
A failsafe in case of a coup like this.
Stiber smiles and moves to Mina. With one of his sharp claws, he nicks her neck, spilling a few drops of blood onto his fingers. Dragola roars in anger, but the Major threatens to kill Mina.
Careful, Your Highness. You don't want to end up a widower again.
With his bloody finger, he presses the button, activating the machine.
I know you better than you know yourself.
Dragola drops his head in defeat as the hatch above opens and the machine powers up. Exterior, Kieran camp, evening. The battle rages on as bolts of electricity-like energy engulf the battlefield. Suddenly, Marduk and the Kierans are suspended in the air and convulse as the energy bolts course through their armor. Clato runs over to Gorgias, who watches in horror.
What's happening?
The end, my dear. The end.
Suddenly, there is a loud explosion that echoes from the Kieran ship. Marduk and the Kierans drop to the ground. The Kierans are stronger than ever and can fly. They climb into the sky and dive towards the Atlanteans. Londo drops his head and weapon, resigning himself to die. Suddenly, Marduk begins to glow bright like the sun and floats up. The Kieran armor he wears falls to the ground as he faces the entire Kieran horde. He lets out a deafening scream, causing him to shine as bright as the sun. The flying Kierans scream in pain as they begin to burn up in the light. The Harkarians, human and Atlanteans all watch in awe as Kierans turn to ashes. Interior Kieran mothership, Dragola's chamber. The machine is a burnt heap of metal. Everyone is unconscious on the floor. Smoke creates a haze in the beam of sunlight that comes through the hatch above. The Major lies dead, having taken most of the blast to his back. Underneath him, Mina stirs. A few cuts and bruises. Through a cracked monitor, STIBOR lifts his head in time to see Marduk annihilate the remaining Kieran forces.
This cannot be.
A ray of sunlight hits the ground where the Major's corpse has landed. It slowly starts to bubble until it catches fire.
But it was supposed to make us stronger.
It also made us vulnerable to the light, you fool.
The general stands up, adjusts his armor, and salutes Dragola.
Forgive me, Your Highness. I failed you.
He limps into the light and bursts into flames, leaving only the armor and ashes. Now just the three of them remain as Dragola turns his attention to STIBOR. A moment of tension as the two stare each other down with bared fangs. They lunge at each other, flying in the air, throwing each other across the room. STIBOR produces his dagger and plunges it into Dragola's gut, causing him to howl in pain.
The age of Dracul is over.
STIBOR picks him up and throws him at the wall where the family crest hangs. Dragola catches his breath and exchanges a sad glance with Mina. He removes the dagger and with unexpected agility flies over STIBOR and plunges the dagger in his back. STIBOR howls as the tip of the blade juts out of his left breastplate. Bleeding and heaving, STIBOR turns in disbelief as Dragola pulls the dagger out.
You condemn me to darkness. For this, I will strike your name from my history.
Stagor's eyes grow wide with anger. Dragola cuts his head off before he can say another word. Mina crawls into the light as Dragola runs to her to pick her up, but the light burns his hand, recoiling in pain. He lowers his head in sadness. Exterior, Kieran Camp. The Atlanteans, Hycarians, and Murdoch cheer at their victory. Burgaius and Cleto shake hands.
Thank you. Without your help, we would surely have perished.
Thank my granddaughter. She is the first Hycarian warrior.
Londo regards San, who blushes.
Well done.
A beat.
We are stuck here forever, aren't we?
Londo nods sadly.
Where will you go?
I believe we will follow the river. Marduk calls the Nile south. We will rebuild our society there. One that reveres the stars, science.
And our ability to defend ourselves.
The Hycarians nod in agreement.
And you?
We'll return to our ship, where we'll use the hyperthermal energy to restore life support systems. Eventually, we'll build a colony on the off chance that we can be rescued.
Regaius looks around at all the destruction.
Do you think there are any left?
Londo shrugs.
They're broken and have no way to reproduce. Let them die slowly.
Kieran Mothership, Dragola's chamber. Dragola takes Mina's hand in his and kisses her deeply.
But I want to be with you, my love.
I am bound to the darkness. Where I will go, you cannot follow.
Please.
There's a city not far from here. With all the chaos, your origins will not be questioned. Go there.
She shakes her head, now Dragola's eyes burn red as he throws what's left of the regenerator at the wall.
Go!
Mina cries and runs out of the room as Dragola falls to his knees, crying silently. Exterior, high-walled city night. The streets are illuminated with oil lamps as men work to rebuild the walls. In the town square, an idol of Marduk is being finished as people bow in prayer to it. Marduk is now draped in royal robes and jewels, is escorted on a chariot through the city and stops in front of his idol. The people turn to see him and throw themselves at his feet in reverence. Among them is Mina, who looks up at him in defiance. One of the remaining temple priests sees this and picks her out of the crowd and drags her, screaming towards the idol, sacrificial knife in hand. The people cheer and sing praise to Marduk. The priest's knife comes down with a killing blow, but disintegrates in the priest's hands.
Enough!
The scared priest lets go of Mina and all the people throw themselves on the ground, silent. She and Marduk exchange a knowing glance.
Life is precious.
He undoes his robes and jewels and tosses the crown to the ground.
Have you learned nothing?
They all stare at him, scared and silent. He sighs and flies away. Mesopotamian hillside. In the forest, Marduk watches from a distance as the lights of the city illuminate the darkened valley. And music echoes against the mountainside.
Don't feel like celebrating?
Marduk jumps and sees Cleto standing next to him.
How did you...
She holds up a machine that resembles a Geiger counter.
Your energy signature. You're truly one of a kind.
He smiles, sadly.
I don't belong there. Not anymore.
A beat.
You can always come with us.
He turns to look at her, and they kiss. Exterior, Romanian forest. A group of hunters dressed in animal furs roast a carcass over a fire. One of them stands as he tells a story.
And then, the evil god descended the heavens and came to live in these very woods.
The other man gasps.
These are women's stories to keep the children from straying from camp.
I heard the evil god drains you of blood, and if you are truly unlucky, he turns you into a creature of darkness like he.
Hunter number two laughs even harder, lifting his spear.
There is nothing I cannot kill with this.
Suddenly, two red eyes burn bright red.
Oh, let's see.
Before hunter number two can turn and scream, Dragola flies out of the darkness, grabs the man, and disappears. The other hunters sit frozen as they hear the hunter's screams echo in the night.